Hi everybody, this is James Lawrence. I have a teaching and it's kind of based on another teaching I just did yesterday. I often do that. I trick you and I don't tell you it's a series. No, it's not really a series, to be honest with you. It's just my adding more scripture to what I had already placed on the teaching yesterday, which was about the fact that men can indeed seek God. Now, if you believe what some of these denominations teach, I almost hate to begin naming anybody. Let me just put it this way. In some of what are called the Reformed churches, they believe that unless God is the one who literally is the one who causes you to seek the Lord, because he places on you this, you know, this irresistible thing where you must, I'll just go ahead and say irresistible grace. I was trying to stay away from having to go back into a teaching that I've already done in a series, but it's okay. I'm just going to mention it long enough to say that they do believe that unless God is the very one who calls you at a specific time, that this irresistible grace comes upon you, that you're not going to receive God. You're not going to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, even though he's come for everyone, the whole world, that whosoever believeth in him. No, still didn't work that way, even though it says that and says it in many places. No, instead, it's only going to be when God calls you at a specific time. Now listen, God knows the specific time. Now here's where people get confused, and I'm going to explain it the best I know how, yet again, but maybe I'll be able to find another little nuance to it that will help you understand it better, I hope. Here, let me give it a try. God knows every single molecule, if you could say it that way, proton, neutron, of anything that's going to even move one direction or another, just even slightly. He knows when a bird falls from the sky. Okay, so that's a present knowing. But he also knows everything that's going to happen like that ahead of it happening. He does, because God is all-knowing, omniscient, as the scriptures say. But is it actually true, even though things run their course as they're going to end up, just like God knows they're going to end up, does it still run its course and we are still in a struggle to where we are either going to follow Satan all the way into eternal damnation and hell, we are, or we're going to accept God's offer of the gift of his Son, who died for us on a cross, shedding his blood, being placed in a tomb after dying on the cross, and being raised from the dead 3 days later for our salvation, if we will believe he did that for us, and we do. Of course, we who are Christians, we certainly do believe it with all our heart. It's the most important truth that we know. Okay, but what is often said, hopefully not as often as it seems like here lately, but I think there's still Christians who know there's choice with mankind and free will. And some people have argued with me so badly over this thing that they say we have made up. There's no free will mentioned in the scriptures. It's mentioned so many times. It's like rolling off a log to just page there and find one immediately. It talks about man's will and that he will either reject God or he will accept him in his life. Okay, and God knows that he's going to, or if he's not going to, he knows, but he didn't select it to happen that way. Man selects it. How do I know? Just like the scriptures I read yesterday that said to seek. Jesus said, seek and ye shall find. Ask and it shall be given you. Knock and the door shall be opened. Okay? So, this means that we seek for God. And some people will say, no, that's after a relationship. You've established relationship with God, which is much more than that. It's being born again in Jesus Christ by the Spirit of God. So you are born again, and after that, then you seek God and you knock and you ask and you. But see, that's not even saying that. The scriptures I read yesterday, and there may be a mention of this and these today, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. That means they haven't sought God's righteousness. Seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all other things will be added to you that you have need of in this life. What you shall eat or drink, or what you'll put on, your clothing. Okay, so I said that in the other video. But what they're saying about that this is actually God doing all this, that you're not even a participator in this process, that they would call, I just say process because I'm looking at it from their point of view. This process in which you may resist God for a while, but then eventually when He wants you, He's going to get you. And believe me, in a good sense, they do mean that. I will say that. They mean that He will save them to the uttermost. You know, as the Bible even says, that's wording the Bible uses. Save, being saved to the uttermost. Okay, so, you know, I'm not saying that some intention isn't good on that, but I really do wonder about some of it. I'm still puzzled to pieces over why people want to change things in the scripture just so it'll fit a certain niche, a certain little nuance that makes them different from other Christians. Okay, I'm saying some of the same things I did before, but I'm going to read some different scriptures here in just a moment. But both thoughts, such as God actually doing this, predestinating on certain things, we have to look at what the scripture says about what specific things it's talking about. Okay, we also have to look at how God does set boundaries for nations. Okay, this is geographical territories, spiritual territories, as theologians would say it. Okay, and I believe that there is truth to that, because I remember the scripture in Daniel saying that the prince of Persia stopped a prayer from coming to him. Or Daniel was actually told this by the angel Gabriel, who was coming to him, and he said, but Daniel penned it in his book, so he is saying it to us. He's saying, this is what happened. Gabriel said, I was stopped by the prince of Persia. Well, could a man stop a mighty archangel? No, sir. There's a scripture in the Bible in which it talks about one angel slaying 185,000 soldiers. Okay, the angels are extremely mighty. Okay, there's no man that's going to stop him. It was a spiritual entity, Prince of Persia. Okay, I'm not going to go further with that story because it'll get me sidetracked a little bit. But it was a spiritual entity that stopped the prayer from coming from Daniel for only 21 days, and then he received the answer. Okay, so praise God for that. But the Bible reveals this. So yes, there are geological, spiritual territories. There really are. Okay, so anyway, as I continue on into the main subject I've been talking about, let me read actually my first scripture in Acts chapter 17, verse 25 through 28. It talks about God is neither worshipped with men's hands, as though He needed anything, it says, seeing He giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed. That is some predestination right there. Okay, and some say, but you said you didn't believe in it, and things. Please, I said from the very beginning that there is a context. I have one video that I didn't think it was my best, but I talked about how there are scriptures that seem to be pointing out predestinations and others that are not, or something to that effect. And it's a while back ago that I did that one, but you might be able to find it if you care to. It's not bad, you know, but it says that He hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if happily they might feel after Him and find Him, though He be not far from every one of us. For in Him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Now he's talking about poets of that time, just like we have poets in this time, and so forth. And he said, even some of your poets have made reference to the fact that in God we have everything within us is because God. Now let me be careful about that. Everything within us that God can work with and save and redeem, but it originally was all made for God, but man fell in the Garden of Eden through sin. Okay, now some people still don't understand that, and I don't know why they think all the evil's in the world, God didn't send it. If that's the case, then the Bible contradicts itself very badly. But it doesn't, folks, it doesn't. It is Satan who came to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. In many scriptures like that. That was John 10:10. But many others say that. Now let me move on to another one, because this one shows that there are things that God does set before appointed. Before appointed by anything else, God appoints it. Okay? But it does not say that unless a person is appointed for salvation or to be lost forever, that's going to be the case, and you know, either way, that God appoints them to be that way. The Bible, why then? Here's my question. I'm not frustrated about this. I'm frustrated because I can't teach it as perfectly, nowhere near perfect. I mean, not as well as I could, you know. But I'm doing the best I can. God does give man free choice. Oh, mercy, you have said something so incorrectly, brother. No, I haven't. God does give choice, because they said, whosoever believeth in Jesus shall have eternal life. Whosoever where? In the world, in the whole world. He sent his son for the whole world, that whosoever believeth. Many other such scriptures as that, but I'm going to read some here in just a second that will show this even further, just like the ones I read yesterday. I'm not going to repeat those, because I already read them yesterday, but they too talk about men seeking after God, asking him for things, knocking at his door. Okay, so does man make a move toward God? The Bible says it so many times. And some people will still say, oh, no, it doesn't. Only everything is predestined. Unfortunately, they believe even evil things are that men do. Say people human trafficked a bunch of kids, and those kids eventually, after being abused horribly for years, they die of drugs because they are kept dependent on the guy that becomes their pimp, as they call them, the slave driver, okay, of the sex slaves, and then they die. Okay, so, and they believe that God actually even predestines that those people do that. Listen, I'm surprised I'm having even anything to do with that belief system, even to correct it, because it is so off the mark. It is so incorrect. It is so fallible and false and heretical, and it is a doctrine of devils, okay? Yeah, God's the one doing that, and I'm a demon spirit that will possess this guy, but it was by God's decree that I do that. Goodness gracious, I tell you. Okay. Hebrews 11:6, but without faith it is impossible to please him. Oh, really? Well, if we needed that faith, it's not, God just drop it directly into our heart without us even, I mean, it's just going to be there, you know. But without faith it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God, let me repeat that, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Okay, Jeremiah 29:13, and I'll read another Old Testament, then one more New Testament. But it says in Jeremiah 29:13, and ye shall seek me and find me, when ye shall search for me with all your heart. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Proverbs 8:17, I love them that love me, and when ye shall search for me with all your heart. Okay, it just says, and when ye shall search for me with all your heart. You shall seek God, you shall find him when you search for him with all your heart. Praise God. Okay. And then the next one in the Old Testament, and then I'll read my last one that's in the New Testament in Matthew. But this one's Proverbs 8:17. I love them that love me. I pray that I did not mix two scriptures while ago. If I did, forgive me, because I read the other one twice, so you had to have gotten it right. Since I read it that way, and you can look it up yourself to make sure I'm right about it. Okay, Proverbs 8:17, I love them that love me. Now, did he say, I love some who love me, but others I hate because I have predestined to hate them? They are predestined to be hated, so I hate them, and so forth. No, I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. Those that seek me early shall find me. Matthew 7:13-14 is the last scripture I want to read. Enter ye in at the strait gate. Enter ye in? Well, I thought you were going to enter in regardless. I thought that it was a set thing that you're going to do that. So what Jesus is saying here is, enter you in at the strait gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Yes, that's true, that there will be many people lost. I mean, I'm not saying, yes, Jesus is right about that. No, I didn't mean it that way. Please understand, I mean, yes, it's true that many will be lost, but did God choose that destiny for them, or did they choose it for themselves? I think from these scriptures and the ones I read yesterday, that it is very definitely a choice of man. Whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life, it says in John 3:16. Okay, but it says, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Find it. The way they talk on this other doctrine, quote-unquote doctrine, they say it's going to find you. Basically, that's what they're saying. This says, few there be that find it. Folks, listen, I'm not playing around and just saying, oh, I'm going to take a few things here and there and just kind of, you know, make it sound like that these people are incorrect and that we have the correct knowledge about it and so forth. And I'm just doing that because, hey, you know, I want to be in argument with someone. I want to be in debate with them. Did you know that that's one thing that I probably dislike almost more than anything else? I do not like to debate people. I've been through it before. I didn't like it then either. Okay? I don't. But when there are innocent people involved that could believe incorrectly because they keep pushing and pushing and pushing, okay, and they speak so eloquently, and, you know, just like a certain one that has a non-denominational, one of the highest churches in the Reformed churches, or not really Reformed, but just in a certain denomination, and he will say, now there is this thing that must be true because you must, you know, and things like that. And listen, it can sound good. They can look good. The church can look good. The people can all look like they're just stuck to what this person is saying. They're just at high attention. But folks, none of that matters. It doesn't make it true. What makes things true are if they are in the scriptures. If the word of God says it, that settles it. Doesn't matter who believes or who doesn't believe in it. If God says it, it's the truth. Now, when people purposefully don't read certain scriptures when they're trying to push their doctrine, that is just that. It's the same thing as being a liar. You're leaving some of it out so that your doctrine can stand out to be true. Okay, that's still false to do that. Okay, thank you for hearing me. I'm going to end now. I wanted to end at about 20 minutes, and I'm going to about get there. So, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. He loves you, and he's coming soon, and I'll talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.